globalization, market unpredictability, altering demographic trends. Now, because of this condition, supply chain management and the technology initiatives are becoming complex. Do you agree that statement? Now, if you consider 10 years ago and now, supply chain management techniques, processes, methods has been taken a curve. It has changed, isn't it? Now, in a period like this, growth of supply chain plays a critical role in most of the businesses, friends. And there is a, in my personal opinion, serious lack of expertise in supply chain management. And that's why SuccessZante collaborating with ISCEA, bringing this webinar series for your doorstep with the objective of enhancing your knowledge. CSCM, Certified Supplier Chain Manager, is the world's best certification program for supply chain professionals. And why SuccessZante is doing this program? It is to demonstrate the capabilities of their students. And every month we do this, every month we bring the best, every month we do this program as a contribution towards building capable professionals just like you. Now, this is one of the prominent certification program done by ISCEA, the Sri Lankan branch for the International Supply Chain Educational Alliance. You must be wondering who I am. My name is Asita Hantan and I am the founder of 1 Minute Motivation online community, a community that shares unheard stories. And I am going to be your host for tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Supplier Chain Transformation Webinar, episode number 10. Shall we give a virtual round of applause? You can share your hearts, you can share your virtual applause. Thank you very much. I feel welcome and thank you very much. Friends, is it okay if I call you friends? Because we are in a learning platform, learning fraternity, right? So we learn from each other. So friends, I guarantee this program is going to give you a huge positive difference and boost your career. And it's definite. I'm going to guarantee you that, right? And we have a prominent distinguished speaker to share his knowledge, to share his wisdom with you. There's a beautiful quotation, knowing is knowledge, practicing what you know is wisdom. So this gentleman is a wise man who is actually practicing his wisdom. And the beauty is he is going to share this wisdom with you. Are you excited for that? If you are excited, type yes in the chat box, show some love, share some virtual applause. Wonderful. Thank you very much. Excited. I'm excited. So let me give a quick introduction about the speaker. Ladies and gentlemen, you already know his name. Sunit, he started his career as a management trainee at Unilever Sri Lanka in year 2004, where he worked through multiple business functions, marketing, planning, project management, and manufacturing over the last 11 years. And during this period, he headed the company's planning functions and also operations at Unilever's instant tea facility. In year 2015, he joined Fonterra Brands as a project manager and then later took on a position of head of manufacturing at Fonterra manufacturing facility here in Sri Lanka. And he also took the responsibility for innovation rollout plans at Fonterra manufacturing facility in Bangladesh. And he joined an organization called Analytical Instruments Private Limited as the vice president supply chain for a period of 2 years. And then in year 2021, month of August, he joined Ansel Lanka as the associate director manufacturing for the industrial global business unit. He lead a team of 1,200 employees, ladies, 1,200, it's not easy. Leading 1,200 employees in the industrial gloves manufacturing operations. And Sunit also completed his BSc in production in engineering with the first class from the University of Peradeniya. And then he completed an MBA from the University of Colombo. And he also an associate member of the Chartered Institute of Management Accounts, CIMA, mostly known as. And Suniti is also qualified as a Certified Supplier Chain Manager, CSCM, voted by the International Supply Chain Education Alliance. He also holds a black belt in Lean Six Sigma and TPM instructor certification. There's more. Right? Ladies and gentlemen, he is a guest lecturer for supply chain subject at the Masters in Manufacturing Management Program. Guest lecturer at the University of Manitoba. He is an active member of the Industrial Advisory Board for the Development of Manufacturing and Industrial Engineering at the University of Peradeniya. And that's why he's the best and ideal person to share this 20 minutes or 30 minutes with you, his knowledge and wisdom. Now, ladies and gentlemen, it is my honor and the privilege to invite Suneeta Kottutanna to the virtual room to share his knowledge and experience. And please feel free to share your comments. And also, if you have any questions, please feel free to type on the comments section. Then we have a Q&A segment, and I'm eager to learn from Sunit. Sunit, I'm giving the virtual control to you. All the very best.
Thank you, Asita. Thank you very much for that introduction. And good evening to all of you. Warm welcome for this session. First of all, a big thank you to Success Zante for giving me this opportunity. I think it's lovely to share one's experience with colleagues, industry colleagues, because at the end of the day, I think this is how we learn. Yes, we can learn a few things from books, we can learn a few things from our education, but we do have to learn from experience and shared experience. So without taking much time, let me get on to the content for today. I hope the presentation's clear.
Yes, very much clear, Mr. Sinha. You can go ahead.
Thank you. Right. So, what we will do today is we'll spend about 30. Sorry, let me just get this right. We'll spend about 20 to 30 minutes on this topic of sales and operations planning for business success. Now, I'm sure that most of you are familiar with this concept of sales and operations planning. The objective for me is not to sort of tell you what it is or the steps of how to do sales and operations planning, but more of how to make best use of it, right? In terms of, and also how to avoid some of the pitfalls that some companies go through. And I'm going to share some of my own personal experience based on the experience I've had in the companies that I have worked for. Also, I have also experienced from some of the case studies that I have discussed with students in some of the programs that I have taught. And therefore, I think I will sort of share some of these points. Now, of course, there may be certain industrial specific points which may not be relevant to your industry. That's fine. I mean, end of the day, you can't have one solution fitting everybody. So just try to grasp the concept. I'm trying to keep it at a very, very basic fundamental level. And of course, we'll be more than happy to have a Q&A afterwards. So for anyone who is not clear of sales and operations planning, I'm sure most of you are, it's a company-wide planning system that tries to, aims to balance the demand and the supply so that it can optimize the business goals. We're looking at a horizon of about 3 to 12 months. Some companies go as much as 24 months, if that's possible. And it's considered what we call at the tactical planning level. It's a process that involves all the key functions of the company, whether it be sales, marketing, supply chain, and when you say supply chain, it's the planning, the manufacturing, the procurement, the logistics, finance, new product development, all the functions get involved in sales and operations planning. And it's probably one of the best tools that companies can use to communicate business plans, top down, bottom up, and across, right? So it's a very company-wide, holistic planning tool. That organizations use in terms of achieving its their objectives in the business. If you look at the key steps of S&OP, you can have a demand planning linked to it, which is aimed at trying to forecast in the demand, where we are trying to understand what we are going to sell in the next couple of months. Then we try to plan our supply. This is to align our capacities, our suppliers, our logistics for that demand. And obviously the demand and the supply may not match to our requirement all the time. This then goes to what we call a pre-S&OP discussion or a reconciliation discussion, where you look at the demand, you look at the supply, you look at the trade-offs that you will make in the demand and supply, you will propose some action, you will make some adjustments to your plan, and then it goes to the executive S&OP, which is at the highest level in the organization, maybe at a board level, maybe with the managing director or the CEO, with the heads of the functions, where the plan will get signed off saying, this is what we are going to do in terms of demand, this is what we are going to do in terms of supply for the next rolling 12 months. And of course, there'll be feedback coming from the executive S&OP that will then feed into the future cycle of the demand and supply process. This is at a very, very base level of how the key elements of S&OP will work. Let me just sort of elaborate it a little bit more into detail. Where I would, this is a way that I would sort of project it. Where there are two legs. The green boxes are the demand side of it, where we say the job is to plan the sale and then you sell the plan, right? And from the blue box, it's the supply part of it, where you plan the supply and you supply the plan, right? So, I mean, basically you try to, you plan something and then you execute it. And in that execution, you will find differences which you will need to reconcile, and that feeds back into your planning cycle. And I think that bottom box of improve the process, I think this is the first key lesson that I want to share. Most people get into an S&OP cycle and they keep running the cycle, but they don't think about improving the process. So you need to have some metrics in terms of understanding whether your S&OP process is working for you, a health check. So you also need to come out of the process and see whether it is working. If it is not working, what do you need to adjust? So I think the first lesson we need to learn is that an S&OP process is a continuously improving process. You can't get it right from day one. You need to try it out. You need to have people working on it. You need to get feedback. You need to measure your targets and your performance against your targets. And then you need to keep improving it. Right. I'm sure most of you would be familiar with the three tiers of business planning, operational, tactical, and strategic. I mean, this is found in any textbooks of management or operations management, very standard model. And like we said, S&OP sits in the tactical planning stage, right? I would like to sort of propose a slightly different view to this triangle, right? Because I personally don't think that this represents the reality in an organization. Let me just twist it up a little bit more, where I put strategic at the bottom and operational at the top. This is not a standard model. Okay, this is something that I've sort of come up with to make my explanation better. The reason I do this is because the standard triangle on your left, where we show the strategy at top, sort of is trying to align with an organizational hierarchy, where you know you say that the strategic plans are at the top of the organization, and you know you have the operational team running at the bottom of the organization. For me, strategy is actually at the foundation of a company. It's something that everything else lies on, right? So I think for me, if you look at it from the building blocks of planning, I would say strategic planning would come at the base, the foundation, tactical on top of it, and then operational is the small part that keeps changing on a regular basis. So operational planning is your day-to-day, you know, yesterday's sales, yesterday's production, last week's shipments. So those are all your operational things, which has a lot of dynamics. I would also drawn to arrows connecting the triangles. This is also to say that these slices of the triangles are not independent. You can't do strategic, tactical, and operational planning independent of each other. They are connected, they are bolted together. And if you don't understand how they are connected together, then you probably will not be able to get the best use of the process, right? So the next lesson is that understand that S&OP is tactical planning, and it sits between strategic and operational, but ensure that you have a strategic, good strategic foundation for the company. leading from this, I think what we see most of the time is we see organizations who get a consultant company to do S&OP. They will come in, they will, you know, spend a lot of time, effort, money, setting up the processes, setting up the teams, having the meetings. And then, you know, after some time, 1 year down the line, you know, you really don't get the results. So I think the key message that I want to share and I've seen happening is that, you know, you can put the best in class consultants on your S&OP process, but if you've got a bad strategy, nothing's going to help you, right? So I think the key takeout is you need to have your strategy. You need to have a good strategy, and S&OP will help the company make the best out of your strategy, right? So that's what S&OP does. But most of the time, what happens is that companies do not have a clear strategy. They try to do various kinds of things. There's no clear plan. There's no clear commitment to one strategy. There's no strategical review. And then they expect the tactical planning to work, you know, in terms of the process. So I think if you're struggling with your S&OP in your organization, if you're having, you know, frequent stockouts, if you're having frequent write-offs, if you're having a frequent, you know, if your execution or your operational planning is firefighting mode, just go back and see whether you've actually got your strategy sorted out. Right? Because I can guarantee that 90% of the time, all the firefighting that happens in the execution mode is because you've not got your strategy clear. Similarly, if you don't have your execution or your operational control in place, right? So S&OP can, you know, you can do a lot of fancy algorithms, you can do a lot of modeling of your forecast and your supply chain. But if you can't execute, if you can't track, if you can't understand what has happened yesterday, if you don't have visibility to the data, right? And if you don't have operational control, then your S&OP will fail. So these are two of the things coming from the tiers of planning that we looked at earlier, where most people struggle to make S&OP a success in their business without focusing on their strategy and the execution. So the important point is that if you want S&OP to work, obviously get your strategy in place, get your execution in place, and then S&OP will help smoothly translate that strategy into execution. So that's why I've shown it as, you know, that the middle gear of a set of gear wheels, it's what translates the strategy into execution. So think of it, if your S&OP is not working for you, just ask yourself, have I got the right strategy? Have I got the right operational controls? And is that why my S&OP is not working for me? Couple of points to remember when you're planning demand. So I'll jump directly to the demand planning part of S&OP. Remember, we have a demand planning part of it and a supply planning part of it. Point number one, I think a few companies still make this mistake where we plan in value, in rupees, in dollars. But remember, what we are planning is demand. Demand is derived from customers. Customers buy products or services for that matter. And they pay or they create value once they decide to buy a certain quantity of product or services from your organization. So it makes sense that you plan your demand also in product. So when you plan your volumes, your demand plans, it has to be in volume terms, either in quantities, pieces, metric tons, kilograms, liters, whatever you do. And then you translate that into a rupee or a dollar term, rather than trying to do your forecasting purely from rupees and dollars, because customers' demand consumption happens in volume. The second point is to your ability to decompose demand in the demand drivers. So if somebody says that, you know, my plan for January is to sell 100,000 units, that's a bulk number of, you know, in terms of demand. You need to understand what the composition of these 100,000 units is, right? You know, maybe you have 80,000 units being sold to regular customers who are your, you know, everyday repeated customers. Maybe you have 30,000 units coming from a new channel that you have opened up. So that's 110. And maybe you are losing a 10,000 units to some competitor activity in a particular region in the country. So when you say you have 100,000 unit demand, you need to understand or decompose the demand into the building blocks and understand, you know, do you know where this number is coming from? What are the building blocks of this demand? The third point leading from that is don't follow forecasting algorithms blindly. There's a lot of fancy tools out there. Artificial intelligence is coming into forecasting and it is getting better and better. But we do see that a lot of new supply chain professionals are sort of blindly allowing the computers to dictate what the forecasts are going to be. Yes, of course, in the future, it will be more and more accurate as the algorithms, you know, become more specific. Their learning capability will be high. So I do believe that, you know, as we improve the technology, algorithms will be better and better. However, I think given the type of change that's happening in the world, I still don't believe that unless the algorithm gets all the variables, it will be able to react to a reality in the environment, right? I mean, something like, you know, what we're experiencing with COVID, I'm sure no algorithm would have been able to predict something like that, right? So when you do your forecasting, yes, you have an algorithm that tells you what to do, but if you also read your daily newspaper, maybe that may also have some insight that may add to your forecasting, right? Maybe it's a new regulation that the government has brought in. Maybe it's a, you know, some change in policy, right? So it's not only to follow your forecasting algorithm blindly, but understand some of the environmental factors that will impact the demand in your market. Last point is, yes, you need to understand the quality of data. Now, most companies have ERP systems, you know, you can take sales data, you can look at sales data, but I do know that most companies struggle with the quality of the data that they have in their systems, because either they've not had the discipline of, you know, following some rigorous data control. So sometimes you take the data and then you really don't trust the data, right? So in such a situation, it's going to be very, very difficult to plan your demand. So for example, when you say demand versus sales, you know, if you sold something 100,000 units last month, that does not mean that your demand was 100,000. Maybe your demand was 150,000, but you had stocks only to sell 100,000, right? So your sales system will record only 100,000. So your sales may not necessarily reflect the demand that was there in the market, right? But if you have visibility to the orders placed by the customers and the sales and the customer service numbers, all that data, you will need to look at all that data to analyze and understand what exactly was my demand in the past, right? So most of the time we see that, you know, people jump right into the sales database, dig out the past sales, you know, draw some fancy graph, you know, put it into some statistical analysis and try to get out a forecast. But that's just one bit of data. The sales data itself does not tell you much, right? So when you do your forecasting, understand the quality of the data that you're using and ensure that you know, like in the other three elements, you know the variables that are going to impact the demand. So I hope I'm clear on that, which will lead us to the next point on forecasting. This is pure textbook stuff. I'm sure if anybody who has done statistics or statistical forecasting would know this, but it's something that we tend to forget, you know, as we sort of get into the process, right? So rule number one is very, very difficult. Of course, it looks nice in the textbook, but when you actually go to the corporate world and you say the forecast is always wrong, as a supply chain person, as a demand planner, that's a very difficult statement to make, because, you know, your job is to sort of get it right. But we all know that forecasting is not an absolute science. There is a margin of error in the forecast that you make, and your job is trying to make, if you're a demand planner, your job is to make that error smaller and smaller, but the forecast will always be wrong. We will come to that in a later slide as to what that means in real life. Aggregate forecasts will be more accurate than individual forecasts, right? So if you aggregate, or if you plan your products at a product category level, so if you take the, let's say, a consumer goods industry, FMCG industry, if you're into personal care products and you are selling shampoo products, then your forecast for the total shampoo category would probably be more accurate than the individual, variant SKU forecast, right? Because statistically, that the pluses and minus errors of the individual forecast will cancel out when you do your aggregate forecast. So the idea is that you should be able to do an aggregate forecast and a detailed forecast, and then sort of, reconcile the two as you go along. Because if you do, most companies make this mistake of trying to be very specific. They want to have more control of their forecast. So they dive right into the individual numbers at the SKU. They'll be forecasting for 400, 500, thousands of SKUs, and they get it utterly wrong. And sometimes, I mean, it's good for you to do that if you have all the information, if your markets are stable. But in reality, you may have to take a step back and say, look, I don't have the capability to forecast at individual SKU level. Can I at least forecast for a product category to start with, right? And stabilize my forecasting process and then go into individual forecast. So just check with, the systems or the organizations that you are in. I mean, it's good for you to run at individual forecast. I mean, you anyway have to plan at that level, but check whether you have the capability of your processes and systems to plan at the individual forecast level. If not, plan at the aggregate forecast level and then start moving towards the individual forecast. Short-term forecast will be more accurate than long-term forecast. Our ability to forecast tomorrow should be higher than our ability to forecast next week. Ability to forecast January should be higher than our ability to forecast July next year. That's the sensible thing. Why I put it as should be in brackets is that we sometimes find that, the longer term forecast sometimes is more accurate, right? Where, in 3 months ago, we forecasted something for December. Last month, we changed that forecast, but we ended up doing what we said we'll do in, 3 months ago. This also happens, right? And this is mainly because of certain biasness we have in our system, where we try to short circuit the forecast in the short term and we get it wrong completely, right? So technically your short term forecast should be more accurate than your long term forecast. But if you are getting the opposite, if your short term forecasts are more inaccurate than your long term forecast, then there's something absolutely wrong in the way you're managing your numbers, right? So these are fundamental statistics that anybody would know, but understand how to apply that into your forecasting process. Understand how you can use it as a health check in your forecasting process to see whether your forecasting process is on the right track. Right. Okay, so this is a bit of a tricky one. Something that I've learned from one of my past organizations and a guru in SNOP who taught me that, this is one of the key things to learn if you want to change your mindset about SNOP is to use the right vocabulary. So I've given two scenarios. So in the first scenario, you forecasted demand for 100 units and, actual sales for the month was 80 units. So, somebody asked what happened. And in the second scenario, you forecasted 100 units and your actual sales for the month was 120 units. And then somebody asked what happened. Now I can sort of guarantee you if you ask this question in your organization and if I do ask any one of you here, I'm sure the answers would be to say that in the first case, sales is lower than planned. We sold less than the plan. And in the second case, we'll say sales is higher than the plan. We sold more than the plan. And the reason, and that's, it's not really wrong, because the reason is we've been taught that the plan is our reference. The plan is the reality. Plan is the truth. And anything we, do against the plan is the deviation, right? I mean, from a planning perspective, it's not really wrong. But if you go back to this previous slide of, the first rule of forecasting saying that the forecast is always wrong. And our job in forecasting is to actually predict the reality. Should we not say that in the first case we over forecasted?
Hello?
Yes.
Hello?
Sorry about that, guys. So the idea is that if you forecast, so in the first point, we thought we would sell 100, but we sold 80. So the idea is that we couldn't guess, or we couldn't estimate that we would sell 80, right? It's not that we sold less, right? It's just that our estimate was off, right? Because the 80 is the reality of the market, right? The 120 is the reality of the market. Our job in demand planning is to try to estimate that reality. So this is it's a simple concept, but it's a very, very powerful tool, because when you start using this language where you think your forecast is wrong, you then, you know, sort of focus and pay attention to improve in your demand planning process. Otherwise, what you find in organizations is that you put a lot of stress on the sales, even on the supply chain, because this applies to the supply chain as well. When you do your planning of saying, you know, this is what it should be, you know, you should be selling 100 units, right? But where did that 100 come from? That 100 came from a statistical forecasting algorithm, right? But the reality may have changed. So a forecast is something that we estimate in terms of what the market demand is. Therefore, let's try to change our vocabulary of saying that the forecast is the one that we got wrong, not that we sold less or we sold more. It's just that we over forecasted or under forecasted. It's a very powerful tool if you use it. It's a bit difficult. It's a very difficult cultural transformation to make, because we've been told to look at the plan as the absolute reality. But like we've sort of agreed, you know, the forecast, that is always wrong, right? So if you think that the forecast is always wrong and the reality is always right, then try to correct your forecast all the time, right? The next point is, again, something that most organizations sort of get wrong, where they think that the forecast is the target, and you will usually end up with situations like you have a sales target of $100,000. First 6 months gone, you've done 30,000, and somebody asks, what's the forecast for the next 6 months? And you will say the forecast is 70,000, right? So this is what some companies do, right? So they think the forecast is what you should be selling, right? And then what they do is they convert that 70,000 into volumes, quantities, and then they hand it over to the supply chain to process the supply chain. Now, the problem here is that forecasting is about estimating the demand in the market, right? And not what you're supposed to sell to meet the target. Yes, your targets matter. Your targets are part of the S&OP process, but not in terms of a forecast. They are in terms of a target. And, you know, in the next slide, we will see how we deal with the target, right? But trust me, this is one of the biggest mistakes the company makes, where they think that forecasting is the same as bridging that gap to your target. And mind you, your customer has no clue about what your target is, and your customer does not care anything about your target. Your customer cares only about the product demand, right? So please do not make this mistake where you make your forecast equivalent to your target, right? So if you make that mistake, then there's no difference in your, then what you're trying to forecast is not what the customer wants, but what your company or your boss, or, you know, your sales director or your finance director or your CEO is asking for. You can call it anything, but don't call it a forecast, because that's not what a forecast is, right? Your job of the sales team, of the marketing team, is to create demand in the market and not on paper, right? Because what you're doing is, by showing that the forecast is $70,000 for the next 6 months, you're creating demand on paper. This demand may or may not be out there in the market, right? So please do remember this. This is a very, very critical mistake that organizations make. You do not want to equate your forecast to the target. These are two different things, and there will always be a gap between your target and your forecast, right? So you wanted to do 100,000. You have made a plan, and that plan adds up to only 80,000. So you have a gap of 20,000, right? And identifying this gap and recognizing this gap is very important, and is probably one of the biggest cultural challenges that organizations face, because nobody likes to go up to the boss or the board and say, look, I am unable to meet the target. I have a gap of 20,000 metric tons or 20,000 units, right? The whole idea is that you identify the gap, and you don't just go and say, I have a gap. You say, you know, I have a gap, and, you know, I have a plan to bridge the gap. But that plan may have certain levels of risk, and you may not have plans on day one of recognizing the gap. So I think the biggest challenge is for the senior teams in organizations. If you want your sales teams to come up and show you forecasts that meets the target to the dot, please be mindful that, you know, of what the assumptions behind such forecasts are. If a team shows that, you know, your forecast is falling short of your target, I mean, do support them in terms of finding ways of bridging that target. But I think it is very valuable that if teams can actually come up and show that their forecasts do not add up to the target, right? Because what happens is, if you have a forecast which is lower than the target, then you would get biased in terms of, you know, planning your activity. You might just do something to get that 20,000 gap, and that's not going to work well for you from a process perspective. So I hope you understood that part of it, where it's critical that you understand what a forecast is. A forecast is an estimate of what the realistic demand is in the market, right? It's not your target. And if your realistic demand in the market is less than your target, then there is something called a gap. And that gap has to be recognized, identified, and plans have to be made to that gap. And as you roll along on the financial year, the idea is to make this gap closer and closer, right? So that's on the demand side of the S&OP process. If you step into the supply chain part of it, right? And because S&OP or supply chain planning is across the organization, one of the key takeouts that I can share is that most of the time you start planning your operation and not really your supply chain, right? So obviously most of you here are supply chain professionals, so you know your supply chain is from your raw materials to your raw material supplier, to your factory, to your warehouse, to your logistics, to your customer. It could be much more complicated than this. Just drawn a very simple, supply chain, right? And understand that your organization is just one small element of this supply chain, right? And what happens most of the time is, you know your factory performances, you know the OEEs, you know the reliabilities, you know your, you know, staffing plans, you know everything in your factory, you may know something about your warehousing, right? So you put all your effort in planning your operations, right? And then you're clueless about, you know, what's upstream and what's downstream, right? You don't know what's happening with your raw material supplier, you don't know what's happening with your raw material source, you may not be aware of what's happening in the market in terms of the logistics. You may not know what's happening with your retail customers, and therefore you are not really planning your supply chain. You are just planning your part of the supply chain, which is not going to be helpful if you want to balance or be reliable, have a reliable plan in your supply chain, right? Yes, it is going to be difficult. You may not have the same visibility you have about your own operation on your upstream and downstream supply chain. That's fine. But more and more companies are collaborating with their supply chain partners, sharing information, sharing insights. And there's a lot of collaborative tools, IT tools that are being used, which will help you to plan so that you know for your product that you have visibility of your supply chain. So that in the S&OP process, you are able to raise the risk of, you know, any supply constraints caused by the supplier or by your retail or by your logistics, right? Whereas most of the time you find that the focus is only on your own operation and you don't have visibility to the extended supply chain. So this becomes a problem because you go and commit as a supply chain on the supply capability for a certain demand. But in reality, you know, once the demand is to be realized, you will understand that you can't supply because, you know, there's something happening at your supplier's end that you were not aware of. So, the point to note is that you need to plan your supply chain and not your operation. Try to get visibility to the end-to-end supply chain in whatever fashion, even if it's a small amount of information, that's a good start. Establish realistic capability in your supply chain. Just like in demand planning, understand what your actual capability is and what your target is. I mean, if you're from manufacturing, let's say you have a output of, let's say, 20,000 units per day, you know, your boss would have given you a target, or, you know, the company would have set a target to increase it to 24,000, you know, through improving efficiencies, OEEs and all of that. But right now you are still sitting on 20,000, right? Or maybe you are on 21,000. So if somebody wants to plan demand for next month and ask you what your supply capability is, if you say, you know, yeah, my target is 25,000 and that's been built into supply S&OP, then you get it wrong because you don't have 25,000 in your hand. It's something that you're aspiring to get, right? So understand your demonstrated capacity for short-term planning. Recognize the gaps. Just like in demand, you will have gaps in supply. Understand those gaps, right? So demonstrated capacity is not only for your factories, it's also for your suppliers, right? So if your suppliers have not been sending items, materials in a reliable fashion, I think we need to recognize that in our planning as part of the risk. Account for outliers, because, you know, sometimes we tend to average things out when we look at capability, but you might have some outliers, take them out. And understand that, you know, capacity is not a single number, right? I mean, somebody says, okay, this line's average capacity is 20,000 units. This line is average 25,000 units, the next line. But in terms of reliability, the line that gives you lesser production may give that production on a more reliable every day in, day out, whereas the average of the, you know, the first line may be, you know, one day you'll get 15,000, another day you'll get 30,000. So you really can't talk about capacity as a single number. Right. So whether it's the capacity or the capability of your machines or the capability of your suppliers, it has to be talked with a factor of reliability built in. Understanding inventory. Of course, inventory is a friend and a foe. It can be your best friend. It can be your worst enemy. But I think the key points is that you need to clearly define the role of inventory in operations and have clear accountability, because, you know, there are situations where, you know, the inventory responsibility is with supply chain, but the decision making is with sales, or, you know, somebody in finance makes decisions on inventory, and, you know, it becomes very confusing in the S&OP process. You should understand your inventory. You should understand the cost of inventory, and, you know, technically inventory is an asset, but most of the time we end up being a liability because we have no clue of what we are carrying, right? So a deeper understanding of inventory is critical for S&OP. You need to know what you're holding, the risk of what you're holding, what's moving, what's not moving, right? And the whole cost of holding. And like I said, in point number one, the key accountability of who makes the decisions on how much to hold, right? So that's a key part of the process. Maybe a little bit of a controversial thing, but again, something that I've seen is that most companies jump on this, you know, lean bandwagon. Where, you know, obviously inventory is a waste. Yes, we do agree. But right now it will protect you from the external environment. You need to bring down your inventory levels because it's a waste. But don't go lean if your supply chain is unreliable. Now, what I've seen with some of the companies is that, you know, they again, like S&OP, they get some consultant, lean manufacturing consultant, lean supply chain consultant, and, you know, they start to do certain lean tools, lean concepts in the organization, right? That's fine. But if you're going lean, if you're bringing down your inventory levels, you need to ensure that your supply chain is reliable, right? I mean, that's an assumption into lean, right? So if you don't have that, you need to be a bit careful. Going lean may actually show that your supply chain is not reliable, right? So then you may have to focus on getting the reliability up first before you get the results of lean, right? And don't do lean for the sake of going lean. Acknowledge that there's going to be compromises when you reduce your inventory. In the short term, there will be some pain. You should be ready as an organization to go through that pain, right? Because most of the time, companies jump onto the lean bandwagon and then suddenly struggle because, you know, they can't meet the market. You know, customer service is compromised, and that's not something that they can afford at that position of time. And appreciate that there is a timeline. You can't go lean in a month or 2 months. That's going to be a journey, and appreciate that. To summarize, I think we've sort of come to the end of the slides. I think just 5 points to take home. S&OP cannot stand alone, right? You need to have proper strategic plans and operational control. Keep that in mind, right? You can't just focus on S&OP and hope it works. Demand planning is the unbiased view of what the what the market wants. It's not what you want. It's not what your boss wants. It's not what you want to sell. It's what the market wants. Escalate the bad news show the gap and find solutions. So if you know you're not going to meet the target, it is important that the gap to the target is shown to the business so that solutions can be found. This is one of the key mistakes that most companies make, because by definition, nobody wants to show a gap to target. Be realistic in your supply capability, understand your supply chain, understand your suppliers' capabilities, understand what they can supply, you know, when they're going to shut down, what are the challenges in logistics. Be realistic. I mean, these days, I'm sure most of you in supply chain would know that especially international logistics is in a very, very challenging situation. All of that with, you know, in a couple of weeks, you know, the Chinese New Year coming in. There's a lot of interruption that we expect in the supply chain. So build that into your realistic plans, right? So, I mean, you can't avoid that. You can't run away from that. And then finally, like we said, you know, understand the role of inventory, who owns it, who makes decisions around it, what does it do to your business? Is it an asset? Are you making use of it, or is it just becoming a liability? So that sums up this discussion about S&OP for business success. I hope you've been able to pick up at least one or two points of the experience that I have shared, and I'm sure we can open up for a Q&A session.
Sunil, thank you so much for sharing your wisdom with us. And to be frank, coming from non-supply chain background, and you have managed to inspire me and encourage me to learn about this particular topic. And we are at the organization that I'm working is actually currently processing the sales and operation planning for the next year. Definitely, I'm going to use some of your intelligence as well. Thank you so much. One of the key learnings that I'm going to take home is, even though we have the best consultants, if the strategy is not in place, it's not going to work out. That's something I'm going to take home. Thank you so much for inspiring me. And I'm sure that you have inspired and educate the audience as well. We can take about three questions. And if anyone who would love to ask any question related to this particular beautiful topic, please raise your hand, or you can switch on your mic and ask the question from Sunil. If not, if you are uncomfortable speaking, then you can use the chat box, type your question here, and we can read it out to Sunil. Until you ask that question, I have a question, Sunil. So something you said about using the right vocabulary. If you can explain about it a little bit more, then I would love to learn.
So Asit, I think that that slide was basically where, when you make a plan, let's say you make a plan to sell 100 units next month, right? And you actually end up selling 80 units. The vocabulary that we use is to say we sold less than plan, because our reference is the plan. Right? And we usually blame the sales guys for not selling what we planned. Same applies for supply chain, right? So we plan production for 100,000 units. When you actually produce only 80,000, we say, you know, you made less than the plan, right? So that's because you keep your plan as your absolute reference, and then you measure the deviation from the plan. Now, what S&OP tells you is that, you know, in terms of demand planning, in sitting in December, you are trying to forecast January, right, with all the assumptions, and you are saying you're planning to sell 100. Now, come January, there's a reality in January where you sell only 80. So, did I actually sell less than the plan, or did I make a wrong plan in December? That's the difference, right? So, if you think that the plan that I was going to make in December is absolute, yes, it is, the sacred number is 100, and therefore I sold less in January, that's the wrong vocabulary to use. But if I come in January and I say, okay, I sold 80, then why did I forecast 100 in December? I made a mistake in my forecast, right? So if companies don't do that, and they think that their forecast is, you know, because they forget that first assumption of saying the forecast is always wrong, if they think that the forecast is an absolute truth, then the ability to correct the forecast and the process goes away. So that's why it's important for you to identify that the forecast can actually be wrong, and it will be wrong.
Thank you, Sunil. I mean, another question aligning with this question rather, you said evaluating the forecast, right? And how frequently you should do this evaluation, and what would be a practical way of doing this evaluation?
So usually, I say the most SNOP processors will have something called an health check, right? So it actually checks the, you know, so the SNOP takes care of, you know, ensuring your customer service, your inventory and all of that. But if you have a good SNOP process, there'll also be a health check, which probably can be done monthly, once a quarter at least. This actually checks whether your process is in place. So again, what happens is most of the time, you know, these consultants would come in, they would put the process and everybody would run it, and we would measure the business performance. But we may not have specific KPIs to check whether the process is working or not. Right. So I think that's where what I meant in terms of having the metrics to, you know, check whether you're, so for example, are your meetings happening on time? Is everybody participating? Do you get your data? Right. Do you have open discussions? Right. So those are health checks, right? Because if you don't have that, then you're not going to get the output. Hi, Sasanka, how are you?
I'm good, Sunit. Great presentation. Just a small question that I wanted to ask now. You covered a lot of factual things, a lot of technical things, but also for a supply chain professional to be influential in the organization, there are a lot of the softer elements that matter, right? Especially in leading an SNOP discussion. Any thoughts there? I mean, Sri Lankan organizations, I still feel, has a lot of focus on, you know, more than the fact-based stuff, still, you know, there are certain sentiment-based, emotion-based things, right? Any thoughts there?
I think valid points, Asanka. I think it's all about the organization culture. Because we've seen organizations, whenever sales leads SNOP, the forecasts are less because, you know, sales is more biased towards, you know, trying to beat in targets, right? I mean, I'm not generalizing, but this is some of the realities. If marketing leads it, you usually get the forecast to be a little bit higher because they are not the guys who are actually going to sell it. They want to sell up the marketing plan. So that's the two ends of why sales and marketing should not be handling the numbers. So then you have supply chain sort of coming in between and saying, you know, I need to be realistic. Now, Sasanka, I think the point is in terms of the maturity of the organization to be, I mean, some people still don't understand why supply chain does demand planning, right? I mean, I've come across this question many times as to saying, you know, supply chain is supposed to supply. Why are they even worried about demand? Demand is something that sales and marketing does. So I think the world has moved a lot in terms of, you know, what supply chain does. So I think it's about having a mature outlook about your operation, about your business. And you know, the sort of the organization having trust on the process and on the team. And I think, I mean, for me personally, one of the, you know, plus points that I do have is I did work in a sales and marketing stint as part of my, you know, in my first role. So I'm actually sort of quite conversant with what happens in sales and marketing. So that gives you a bit of an added advantage when you sort of talk to your colleagues in sales and marketing, because you do come from the background, you have the ability to empathize. So I think, I know it may not be practical for everybody, but I think for a supply chain professional, please do take the time to empathize with sales and marketing. Sales is a very, very tough job. Getting somebody's money is the hardest thing you can do, right? Supply chain just spends money, right? I mean, that's our job, we spend money. But getting somebody else's money is very, pretty tough. So I think if you can sort of empathize, connect, sort of, you know, try to work with sales, try to experience sales, I think that will help sort of build that relationship.
So thanks for the answer, Sunit.
Sunit, we have a question from the audience. Suvani is asking, what kind of KPIs can review SNOP performance other than the forecast accuracy?
So again, like I said, look at the leading indicators. So forecast inaccuracy is also a result of what we do. So leading indicators are more qualitative, not really qualitative. It's like to see whether your process is in order. Like I said earlier, do a health check to see whether your meetings are happening on time, whether the senior team is involved in the meetings, whether you have plans. So there's usually, if you have a proper SNOP process, they'll usually give you a I mean, if you're taking it from a consultant, there's usually a checklist of stuff that you need to ensure. If not, I'm sure you can sort of develop it on your own. This is to check whether your process is right, right? So it's not about calculated numbers. It's not about forecast formulas. It's simple things like, you know, I mean, we in one of the companies, we had one of the golden rules was that the S&OP meeting will not, the date will not change, right? Despite, you know, nobody can, even the CEO cannot change the date of the S&OP meeting, right? Now, that's an important element of your health check. If you have that, that means that the company gives you that value to the process. But if you have a company where the S&OP calendar keeps shifting every month, right? And every week, you know, we want to postpone it today. That guy is not there. Marketing is not there. That's an indicator that you have a problem with your S&OP because it's not taken seriously, right? And if people don't turn up for meetings, you have a problem, right? So I think it's not KPIs in terms of, yes, that you have your final deliverable KPIs like your customer service, your inventory, your forecasting accuracy, but look at more of the lead KPIs to show that you have a good process. Everybody is engaged. Everybody takes it seriously. And there are a few things that you can use to measure that. Yeah?
Thank you, Sunil, for answering. I believe Suni received the good response from Sunil. So one question from my end, Sunil. I know CSCM has been supporting you in this in your journey. How is your journey? Would you like to share some life experience about this journey?
I think CSCM. I mean, I recently actually got involved in CSCM. So I've been with supply chain for quite some time. I'm actually from a more of an engineering manufacturing background. But, you know, as you saw recently, I actually worked for a sort of a trading organization moving to supply chain. And then I sort of realized that I do need to enhance my knowledge in terms of supply chain practices. The world has become a bit more complex than what it used to be. And then, so, you know, I sort of wanted to equip myself with some, you know, confidence of, you know, saying that, you know, I've sort of covered, I've covered my bases. So that's where I sort of found CSCM to sort of help me with that. And I know a lot of my colleagues who had gone through the program. And I think the wonderful thing about CSCM is, it's not just the content or the books or, you know, the exam content. It's the value of the, the panel, right? Very experienced set of panelists that, you know, that do the lectures, and it's all like experience sharing, right? And, you know, that actually helps in terms of, learning. So I think for me, CSCM has been a wonderful experience, especially with the experience. And also, you know, you have a group of people who come from very different backgrounds, from Sri Lanka, from Bangladesh. The markets are very different. The challenges are very different. And, you know, we work in a global environment. So, you know, we can't be just confined to what happens in Sri Lanka. So I think that's been a brilliant experience to me.
Thank you so much, Sunit. And I know it's a Monday evening, and investing time to learn is uncomfortable, but you have break that uncomfortable door and opening yourself to new ventures, new opportunities. And this is where we learn. And thank you so much, Sunit, for sharing your wisdom with us. And friends, ladies and gentlemen, if you really wanted to stand out from the crowd, just like Sunit, or maybe better than Sunit, please do join with, enroll yourself with CSCM. The new enrollment is happening on 19th December. And our backend team will share the Google form here on the chat box. And whoever is interested, please fill the Google form and our team will connect. And there's another question actually from Kasun. Sunit, do you have another 2 minutes to answer?
Sure.
Yeah, thank you. How to get innovation forecast right and plug it into the S&OP process?
Okay, so Kasun, nice to hear from you. I think one of my former colleagues. I think this is a tricky one because innovation is about something new. You really don't know about it. So I think treat it like that. Don't treat innovation with the same level of confidence that you have for your regular forecasts. Keep it, yes, you build it in your forecast, but, you know, sort of protect it so that everybody understands that this chunk of, you know, forecasting comes with a lot of risk, where you have no clue of what's going to happen. Do scenario planning. I think what we, I mean, I don't have too much time, but what we call dynamic planning, where you have, you know, you do a couple of scenarios. Okay, what if we have 20% growth? What if we have 10% growth? What if this whole thing crashes? What's our risk on inventory? And then look at whether the business is ready to take, because, you know, end of the day, you can't exactly model innovations. You can pay millions of rupees to market research organizations just to find that by the time you launch the product, the market has changed. I know many large companies that failed miserably because they just took the market research information in face value. So the idea is that I think the best thing is to do scenario planning and see what level of risk the organization is willing to take to drive the innovation. And then from there, build it into the forecast, but always sort of show it as a separate risky part that you build into the forecast. I hope that's a simple explanation that I can give.
Thank you so much, Sunit. And ladies and gentlemen, it is an honor and privilege to host tonight educational program, I would say. And it has actually planted the content, as Sunit shared, has planted a seed in my mind for me to learn about supply chain more. And thank you very much, Sunit, for investing time with us. And I also thank all these 27 participants for investing time on a Monday evening. And I wish you nothing but the best, Sunit. May your journey grow immensely, and may you have the power to inspire more individuals. Thank you very much. And thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for connecting with us.
Thanks, Aditya. Thank you, everyone. Good evening.
The most profitable companies in the world have learned to use their supply chains to keep goods and services flowing into the marketplace. But supply chain processes are only as good as the people who keep them running. Supply chain employment opportunities are constantly being created, and ISCEA certified professionals are getting the best paid jobs. If you wish to become a sound supply chain professional and gain real world experience and knowledge, then ISCEA is your one-stop source for supply chain education, certification, and recognition. ISCEA is the International Supply Chain Education Alliance. We were the first organization certifying supply chain professionals around the globe, and we remain the worldwide authoritative resource for supply chain career validation, with thousands of certificate holders commanding top-tier salaries. Our certification programs are aligned with best practices and industry-proven standards. They bring together academic research advances and innovative industry trends, validating that you have the knowledge used by top companies to remain competitive in an ever-changing business environment. For your company, that translates into significant cost reductions, faster revenue growth, and a collaborative teamwork environment. For your career, it means exceeding everyone's expectations and taking control of your future. So, what are you waiting for? Stand out from the crowd and take your career to the next level with an ISCEA internationally recognized supply chain certification.